We stand for the Angelus. The angel of the Lord declared unto Mary, and she conceived by the Holy Ghost. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Behold the handmaid of the Lord, be it done unto me according to your word. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Pray for us, O Holy Mother of God, that we may be made worthy of the promises of Christ. Let us pray. Pour forth, we beseech you, O Lord, your grace into our hearts, that as we have known the incarnation of Christ, your Son, by the message of an angel, so by his passion and cross, we may be brought to the glory of his resurrection, through the same Christ, our Lord. Amen. O precious light, pure brightness of the everlasting Father in heaven, O Jesus Christ, holy and blessed, now as we come to the setting of the sun, and our eyes behold the vesper light, we sing your praises, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You are worthy at all times to be praised by happy voices, O Son of God, O Giver of life, and to be glorified through all the worlds. The hymn number 99.
Thank you.
Good evening, my brothers and sisters in Christ, and welcome to this act of worship of Evensong today as we observe the eve of the Feast of the Conversion of St. Paul. Our service continues with the versicles and responses for Evensong.
O Lord, open thou our lips. O God, make speed to save us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
Appointed Psalm 119, verses 89 to 112.
Lord, Lord, have mercy. A reading from the Word of God, written in the book of Sirach, the 39th chapter, beginning at the first verse. He seeks out the wisdom of all the ancients and is concerned with prophecies. He preserves the sayings of the famous and penetrates the subtleties of parables. He seeks out the hidden meanings of proverbs and is at home with the obscurities of parables. He serves among the great and appears before rulers. He travels in foreign lands and learns what is good and evil in the human lot. He sets his heart on rising early to seek the Lord who made him and to petition the Most High. He opens his mouth in prayer and asks pardons for his sins. If the great Lord is willing, he will be filled with the spirit of understanding. He will pour forth words of wisdom of his own and give thanks to the Lord in prayer. The Lord will direct his counsel and knowledge, and he meditates on his mysteries. He will show the wisdom of what he has learned, and will glory in the Lord of Lord's covenant. Many will praise his understanding. It will never be blotted out. His memory will not disappear, and his name will live through all generations. Nations will speak of his wisdom, and the congregation will proclaim his praise. Here ends the first lesson.
The office hymn, 418.
Thank you. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles, the 9th chapter, beginning at the 1st verse. Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless, because they heard the voice but saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight, and neither ate nor drank. Now there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias?" He answered, "Here I am, Lord." The Lord said to him, "Get up and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment he is praying, and he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who invoke your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings and before the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." So Ananias went and entered the house. He laid his hands on Saul and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on your way here, has sent me so that you might regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes, and his sight was restored. Then he got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. For several days he was with the disciples in Damascus, and immediately he began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogue, saying, "He is the Son of God." And all who heard him were amazed and said, "Is not this the man who had made havoc in Jerusalem among those who invoke this name? And has not he come here for the purpose of bringing them bound before the chief priests?" Saul became increasingly more powerful and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus was the Messiah. Here ends the second lesson.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Preaching of your Apostle Paul, you have caused the light of your gospel to shine throughout the world. Grant, we pray, that we, having his wonderful conversion in remembrance, may show ourselves thankful to you by following his holy teaching. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. O God, from whom all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works do proceed, give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee, we being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness, through the merits of Jesus Christ our Savior. Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy, defend us from all perils and dangers of this night. For the love of thy only Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord.
May the divine assistance remain with us always, and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Amen.
The hymn before the sermon, hymn 761.
Thank you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, through weak human words, give us grace to hear your true and living word, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. What's in a name? That which we call a rose by any other name would smell as sweet, stated Juliet. But what if it was a stinking missy? Romeo Montague and Juliet Capulet met and fell in love in Shakespeare's lyrical tale of star-crossed lovers. But their relationship was doomed from the start as members of two warring families. Here, Juliet tells Romeo that a name is an artificial and meaningless convention, and that she loves the person who is called Montague, not the Montague name and not the Montague family. Romeo, out of his passion for Juliet, rejects his family name and vows, as Juliet asks, to deny his father and instead be newly baptized as Juliet's lover. From this scenario, we may deduce that even though much may be in a name, family ties, history, and legacy, sometimes we may have to lose that name so that we can, as Juliet said, be newly baptized, or as 2 Corinthians 5:17 advises, become new creations in Christ. The old has to go away to make room for the new. Speaking of names and new, this evening is the eve of the celebration of the conversion of Apostle Paul, formerly known as Saul, whose original name certainly could not be associated with beauty or any delightful aroma due to his persecution of God's people. For Paul, though his name change was involuntary, it offered him a new start and a new, much more meaningful perspective on life and the way. He definitely became a new Christly creature. Today, many persons are longing to change their life, fortunes, or perspective, and wish it was as easy as Paul's conversion on the road to Damascus may appear. I hasten to inform you of two important facts in this regard. One, Saul's conversion to Paul was initiated by God for his purposes. Remember what the Lord said to Ananias in verses 15 and 16. Go, this man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings, and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. And two, God is the only change agent. Who could ever imagine Saul, chief persecutor of the church in Jerusalem, could have experienced a 360-degree change in personality and perspective? But the Lord instructed Ananias to go and place his hands on Saul to restore his physical sight and replace his spiritual sight. It is also interesting to note that before his conversion, Paul was a dedicated adherent to the Jewish faith who truly believed in the truth of the Old Testament and most probably was anxiously awaiting the Jewish Messiah. Paul considered Christianity to be a false religion, a religion that was in direct conflict with the Jewish tradition he so devoutly followed. He was so zealous for Jerusalem and so against this new religion that he actively persecuted Christians. This is why Ananias brought implicating facts against him to God in verses 13 and 14. But God had a plan for Paul, the same way he has a plan for us. God has plans. From the very beginning when he created this world, he had a plan. His plan is good because of the purpose it will serve. It is good because of the hope it will give. It is good because of the lives it will save. But really, it is good simply because of the God who calls it so. God has plans, has them for you and he has them for me. He knows the span of our life before we are formed in our mother's womb. He knows the hairs on our head, the thoughts in our mind, and the hours that we will live on this earth. He will not leave such attention to detail merely to chance. God has plans for us, and they are good. So while Saul may have been planning his moves, as heard in the beginning of Acts chapter 9, breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples, going to the high priest for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. Proverbs 19:21 warns that many are the plans in the mind of a man, but it is the purpose of the Lord that will stand. It should therefore come as no great surprise to us that Paul went on to write a large percentage of the New Testament. God used Paul to record many of the doctrines and teachings we Christians live by today. And though he was not one of the original 12 disciples and had never met Jesus before Jesus was crucified, Paul came to be a devoted follower of Jesus after Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, when Jesus confronted him personally. In Philippians 3:7-11, a brief account is found of how Paul weighed everything about his life and all his accomplishments, goals, and attainments, and saw that suffering with and for Jesus was worth more than anything he could ever be on his own. He states, "But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible, I may attain the resurrection from the dead." According to Robert Driscoll, BA in both pastoral ministries and biblical studies from Mid-America Christian University, the conversion of Paul shows us several things. When one is truly saved, that persons care more about what God wants than what the self wants. Paul also recognized that his encounter with Jesus was the beginning of his walk with God. Too many professing Christians think that once they have said a sinner's prayer, their place in glory is set, and they can go on with their life as before. Paul, however, knew that his life of true faith had just begun, and he bore the responsibility of keeping his eyes on Jesus, the source of salvation. What could turn a man around who was so dedicated to his beliefs and so intent on squashing the beliefs of others? Only the loving power of Jesus Christ. As many people experience today, Jesus is still the same as he was in Paul's day. As Christians around the world can attest, Jesus can still have a hard heart, can still take a hard heart and make it live again. All it takes is for one to respond to Jesus' call as Paul did. So what's in a name? I say everything. It is believed a good name is better to be had than silver and gold. Are you a rose or a stinking missy? How do people feel or respond when they hear your name? To those who know, and to those who do not know they are in need of a change, God is more than willing and able. And while he may not change our name, the adjectives used to describe us certainly can be changed. The fruit of the Spirit come to mind: loving, joyful, peaceful, persevering, kind, good, faithful, gentle, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord, support us all the day long of this troublous life, until the shades lengthen and the evening comes and the busy world is hushed. The fever of life is over and our work is done. Then, Lord, in mercy, grant us safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
And now to God's gracious mercy and protection, I commit you this night. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace, this night and forevermore. Amen. The hymn 16.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Amen.